Welcome to the second day of the DDoS conference, and we start today off with a very hot topic, PRISM, and all the other stuff the NSA has done to us all in this age and time. Please welcome Maurice Verhezen. He's going to tell us everything about what he thinks is needed to do about PRISM.
Well, thank you, Jean-Paul. Thank you all for coming so early on Sunday morning. It's very nice to see so many people. I'm Maurice Verhezen. I'm the Dutch Fellowship Coordinator for the FSFV in the Netherlands. And today we're gonna talk about PRISM. A lot of these topics that I'll be discussing are pretty much my personal opinion, because the FSFV hasn't officially yet made a big official standpoint about the whole topic. So a lot of this is just me talking. What are we going to talk about? Well, when I was working on this presentation, it's one of the I think one of the most difficult presentations I ever had to make, because each day when you made another slide, the next day it was old news and you had to start all over again with all the revelations coming out each day. So that was very, very difficult. And what also makes it extremely difficult is that it's a difficult topic to explain. But I tried, so here we are. First, we're going to talk about the effects of surveillance, why the surveillance that is currently being done is actually not a healthy thing. That's the political stuff. Then we're going to get to the technology stuff. We're going to look at all the things Snowden revealed, how they work together. And that's technical, so we're going to look at what technologies that they are using and how the whole surveillance system actually works. And then we're going to discuss how to limit the surveillance. What can you do to guard yourself from all the surveillance? And then we're going to have a short conclusion. Okay. But first, we need to go back a little in time, just to see why the current surveillance is bad. And I always show this slide because I think it's extremely important, because this is what we've been doing as mankind for the past thousands of years, and that's sharing knowledge. And that's something we have been doing for thousands of years. It started, you know, with a little rock that we used as a knife. And because then we traveled around in the world and didn't live at certain cities or something, we almost never got to know other people. So it took a long time before ideas spread, like getting from this rock to this rock, which is just a minor step. But it took thousands of years. And then at some point we get to the Middle Ages, and there were monks writing and copying books. And that was the knowledge that was spread, the things that were in those books. But at some point we found the printing press. And then for another couple of hundred years, the only book that was printed was the Bible. So still not that much different knowledge being spread. But then at some point people started to print other stuff, because it was easier to make a printing press, and so other people could start sharing knowledge. And they did so, and that caused the Age of Reason, and there we got around sharing a lot of ideas and freely discussing them. And from that point on we actually see an extreme amount of innovation happening. At some point we got trains, we got cars, and that made traveling around a lot easier, again making it possible for people to meet and share knowledge. And that's extremely important, because sharing knowledge is what causes innovation and progress. So this is the summary. We are all different, you know, everybody has a different opinion, and it's through discussions with each other that we share and learn those different opinions, and from sharing and learning about those different opinions you get other opinions and you start changing your own view and combining them, remixing ideas. So diversity, you know, everybody is different, with the freedom to share those ideas and those principles will gain you innovation. And innovation causes, of course, progress for all mankind. So what happens if you add total indiscriminate surveillance in this equation? When you know that you are being watched, but you don't know how or why, this will cause a so-called chilling effect. And this is actually a term. I didn't know that it was that it existed, but I found it out. It's an actual actual term. It causes a chilling effect, and this lowers the diversity because everybody. I'll explain what chilling is a little bit later, because it lowers the diversity and it limits your freedom, and therefore it has a negative impact on innovation and therefore on the progress of humankind. So how does this chilling effect work? Maybe you know this. This is what happens a couple of weeks ago, where a young Moroccan couple posted a photo of themselves kissing in on Facebook, and well, that caused a lot of problems, because actually it's not allowed in that country to do this. So the chilling effect describes that if you know you are surveilled but you don't know how or why or for how long, then you will stop doing these kinds of things. You will start behaving and start self-censoring yourself to this idea that you think is allowed in a country. And the thing is, you don't know what you need to keep secret yet, because it can very well be that in a couple of years laws have changed, and the things you shared are then illegal. And if everything is stored and everything you do is monitored for years and years and years, maybe in a couple of years you find yourself that you are guilty of something that wasn't punishable years ago. So you start behaving in a very plain way, and you start looking at everybody, and everybody starts looking at each other, and everybody just starts behaving the same. And probably, especially, the most strange and most funny ideas won't be shared, because everybody will think, hey, this is something to look out for and not do. And another thing that that you can see here, this is actually a pretty interesting picture, because this happened a couple of days later, when a lot of people within the Moroccan community thought, well, this is actually a very stupid law that we can't kiss in public. So they just started doing this everywhere, and they got the press involved, and well, they made a protest. And this is today still possible, because those people believe that when they do this, they won't get arrested, because there are a couple of people and it's difficult to find out who's who in this picture. But if you have total indiscriminate surveillance, then with facial recognition and a good security agency will find out everything about these people within seconds. If the NSA wanted, I'm pretty sure they could just find out everything about these people. And what if the Moroccan government had this capability? Then all these people, it would be very easy for the police to arrest all these people, because yeah, you just get their address and you just go there and pick them up. And at that point, if that happens just once, nobody in this in that country will ever do a protest like this again and show, you know, that there are a lot of people that think the law is should be changed. And that's the chilling effect. When everything is surveilled, it makes protests and changing of and behaving differently impossible. So the end result is that you stop sharing ideas and you stop hearing really strange ideas from other people. And those strange ideas may generate, you know, other interesting things in your head that you never thought about. And so it all boils down to that progress and innovation in society just stops. So we're not just talking about, there's a question or?
I think I already kind of experienced the chilling effect in that sense. Sometimes I'm kind of interested in some chemical reactions, chemical formulas, but I think, well, let's not look it up on Google because then they will think I'm looking for bomb recipes or so.
Yeah, exactly. So a person in the audience said that he already experienced the chilling effect because, you know, it might not be the best idea to Google certain chemical substances because those substances might be used to create a bomb, and you know, you are afraid that some people will find out, and you're just studying chemistry. But you know, it could be used for creating a bomb, and then you just stop learning from that stuff that's on the internet. It's already happening. Yeah. So basically, it stops you from sharing ideas, and you see it happening in Russia in this with the whole. Thing that happened with those artists in Russia, that when they got prosecuted, you know, already people stopped sharing new cool ideas.
No, that's not true. People did not stop sharing. I'm actually Russian, so I know this account from first-hand account. My sister still lived there.
Ah, okay.
People did not stop sharing the ideas. It was the deep divide between atheists. Mm-hmm. And people who believe God, pretend to believe in God. And what it does, it causes the chilling effect that atheists don't want to stay in Russia.
Yeah.
For Europe.
Yeah, so the reaction in the audience was that it caused this whole story caused a divide. And people who don't agree with what was happening, the prosecution and everything, they just leave Russia. Well, that might be, but it's not really a solution, in my opinion. You should be able to, you know, express your opinion, I believe. And yeah, so then also the sharing stops because those people just leave and they won't be in the whole discussion. So in the end, yeah. Sharing stops.
I live in Russia and I'm pretty familiar with the chilling effect. And I know that we all behave similarly. We are trying to look like others. Even sometimes we even dress like others, just to be as everyone else in every sense. So look, talk, think, and behave in public as everybody else. As little difference as possible between individuals.
Wow, that's interesting to hear. Yeah.
The chilling effect. It is not possible if authorities have no physical power over you. You know, if they perform surveillance, but they cannot extort physical. Physical actions against you, there will be no chilling effect. Chilling effect is based not on the surveillance, but mostly on the fear, on a threat of a physical violence against you from authorities.
Yeah, exactly. But it becomes easier for the physical violence, because you first have to know who and where somebody lives.
Actually, and it is not easier. If you have physical power, you can extort it against those who are weaker than you, regardless of civilians. If you have power, you don't care if you punish a guilty person or innocent person. That's the point. Civilians actually don't add anything to the picture if they can punish you for nothing, as they practiced in Russia for decades. Without any civilians, in all the 20th century, Russia was a hell on earth without any civilians.
Yeah, well, that's true. You can just pick random random people up, but I think it was a different time, and where we live now in the West, it's really horrible that we actually have and experience a chilling effect because of the surveillance. You know, it's not even the threat of the physical violence, which actually is easier and can follow after surveillance, but that even without the whole physical threat, apparent physical threat, we still experience it somehow. I mean, as the guy just said in the audience. Let's do the questions at the end of the presentation, because I believe I'm already a bit behind schedule. So otherwise, I'll keep it up. So if that's okay with everybody, then we'll just do that. All right. So let's just look at the technical stuff from the NSA, the current surveillance practice. Well, Snowden has revealed a lot of different programs that are used by the NSA to surveil. And basically, the whole system breaks down to two things. First, there is the acquisition, the snooping programs that just kind of hoover up all the data from different sensors. And there's the analyze step that follows after the surveillance. And those are two different things, and all the Snowden documents, it just goes a little bit it's not completely clear where the thing ends and the other thing starts. I listed a couple. I'm just gonna walk through them. The next slide. Connected. So if you don't understand how it's all hooked up, that's fine. That's the next slide. But I'm first gonna explain all the different names here. Well, the first thing that we're gonna talk about is PRISM. And PRISM is actually a program that is used by the NSA. Not a computer program, but a surveillance program or activities that are used to get data from Facebook and Twitter and all these kinds of companies. So that's direct data about people. So they can actually do a request for information about a certain individual, and then Facebook has to give them a copy of everything. So that's very high level. They actually have to make a request, and that's all in the secret courts and with the FISA courts, and they have to go through this rubber stamping process to get this. But they always get the data. When they ask, they will receive it. So that's PRISM, and the PRISM stuff falls under this the special source operation division, and they are responsible for that sensor. So PRISM is actually one of the sensors, one of the data sources that the NSA has. On the other end, you have Boundless Informant. Because there are so many programs that the NSA is using, and so many sensors, and so many so-called SIGADs, those are the places where the surveillance happens, that they actually have a system to keep track of all the things that they're doing. And that's Boundless Informant. It's a business intelligence software. By the way, it's free software that they're using there. It's GNU Linux and a couple of web servers and databases. And they use regular business intelligence to keep track of all their places where they listen to stuff and all the sources of information. So that doesn't actually contain any data about people or organizations or whatever. It's just a way of bookkeeping for the NSA to keep track of what they're all doing, because it's so much. They actually need a system like that. Then you have Upstream. Upstream is just a sort of container term for all the different sensors that they have. And they have things like Fairview and OakStar, and GCHQ calls it Tempora. It's all these different systems to all these different programs to tap into, for instance, international cables or satellites, or that's the FormSat stuff. Or F6, that's actually a program that they use to hack into embassies, and all these different sensors are being controlled by parts, by groups of the NSA, and they have those nice names like Fairview and OakStar. Then you get X-Key Score, and this is actually the search engine that the NSA looks, if you will. This thing uses all those sensors and stores data, and then analyzes this data. It parses all the data it gets and combines it. So it extracts address books, it extracts IP addresses, it extracts even email accounts, anything it can find in the raw data that they can see traveling over cables or through the air, or whatever sensor that registers it. And that's, of course, for the whole world, it's an extreme amount of data. So they only have a 3-day rolling buffer of all the stuff that we're communicating right now. So it's near real time. And of course, it's a distributed system built with GNU Linux again. And it runs all over the world, so in every every country or something like that, there are a couple of Linux servers just parsing through the data and running it. Then you have a program called Bull Run, and Bull Run is I find it pretty astounding. Is an operation where the NSA actually tries to distort, you know, the whole process of, for instance, the IETF, you know, the Internet Engineering Task Force, when they are building a standard to make it insecure. So what they would do is just have a physical person just say, maybe we should do it this way, and everybody agrees, and this way is actually not a very technical, good technical solution, because, you know, the NSA already has a way to hack into it. But it goes further than just the public the public groups that they can just join and try to influence. It's also together with Microsoft, find weaknesses in for instance Windows or in other software, so they can actually have a zero-day exploit that they can use to crack into anything. This is also the place where they do the research for or against encryption. So they are trying to break encryption and build supercomputers to do something like that, or at least it's very reasonable to assume that they use supercomputers for this. And Well, these are just a few programs that Snowden has revealed. There are many more. And well, the thing is, it's also extremely hard to figure out how everything fits together. And with another Snowden revelation, it could very well be that, you know, the whole picture shifts a little bit. So it's as certain as as we can get today these slides. So this is the whole picture, how it all fits together. It's still not the best picture. I found out I did a drawing myself, which made it a little bit more clear, but I didn't really have the means to make that well, pretty enough for the presentation. So we'll just go through it a little bit. Well, here you have these names like Fairview and Oakstar. They hoover up the data. So when you have an ISP or an internet exchange, this is the program that actually taps into those, and they have different names. So for each country or for each region, we still don't know exactly how it's being named. You have something like this. Well, the British are doing the same thing. So they actually tap into all these network providers. And here you have Prism, which, like I said, I don't believe it's completely real time. They actually have to go through some sort of rubber stamp process to get the information within Prism. And in the middle, you have the whole X key score system that just collects all the data from all these different sensors, all these different SIG ads, and parses it to get you know, telephone numbers, email addresses, and address books. So when one contact has, you know, contact with many people, they actually can build an address book based on who you are communicating with. So that's really interesting. And at the top you have the boundless informant. Well, like I said, that's just a program they use to keep track of all these different SIG ads that they have, all these different sensors that they have, because, you know, they collect a lot of data and they need to manage it somehow. So they need to know where and how many things they are actually collecting and doing. And at the other end, you have Bullrun, which is just a separate division or separate program. We don't know exactly. That is focused on hacking encryption and making sure that there are backdoors in, I don't know, pretty much everything out of the United States. So the conclusion is that there's pretty much a verboten copy of any signal transmission in the whole world, and that means just a literal copy. So if it's encrypted, it's, you know, the rubbish that you send over the line. But it's actually a copy.
You mean also the payload or also the metadata?
Everything. Yeah, because, you know, you can't. They, if you look at the Snowden slides, they just get the whole request stuff, and when you there's also data in there, and they know that, and they also use that. So it's not a clear line between metadata and real data. You will have a mix. Yeah.
I think it's important to realize that even if you encrypt something and they can't read it now, that if they store it, they might be able to read it several years from now.
Yes, exactly. I'm coming to that point. Yeah, he said that it's actually very much reasonable to think that they will store the encrypted data now and just decrypt it later when they have the technology to do that. So just be sure everything is monitored and copied. This has already been for years and years and years, because the NSA hasn't done this just now. It has been doing this for, I don't know, 50 years or something. But then it was a lot of wire through the air, radio signals that they received and just stored and tried to make sense of. They're actually still doing the same, but then on an internet level. So as a consequence, and all the stuff Snowden revealed about who they are actually monitoring, it's safe to assume that any high-risk communication between whatever, activists, politicians, doctors, lawyers, journalists, everything is being monitored actively. So if you are on some sort of, if you are just a little bit interesting for the NSA or for the United States in general, your communication is just monitored. Rest assured. The problem is that you can only we go to the protection part in the next step. You can only protect a little bit. Because a lot of metadata that you generate, it's very hard to, it's extremely hard to make that go away. So you always generate information. I heard this morning when I was driving to this conference that the NSA can tap pretty much everybody except the president of India, because he doesn't have a cell phone and doesn't use a computer. So, but even there, they have F6, and F6 is a special division that wiretaps embassies and that kind of institutions. So even the communication that somebody else within this organization puts down on in an email or transmits over some sort of line will get picked up anyway. Any American service is infiltrated, or at least can be, because of just the law. The NSA can step, can go to any American company and just say, "Hey, we have the Patriot Act. We want the data of this and this person." They can always do that. So, if you use any American service, you can rest assured that there is a way for them to get the data. Even if they don't just don't tap you, they can always just ask. So what's under our control and what's not? Well, the first part, the whole snooping thing and PRISM, if you use an American service and the NSA goes over there and asks for the data, that's something you just can't protect yourself against, because it's out of your control. It's out of your local control. So everything that has to do with PRISM and upstream is just, it's a mass surveillance. It's the verbatim copy of everything that goes over over the internet or any other line. You can't do anything about that. That it's being done. What is under our control is what they then can do with the data, because if you send stuff encrypted, they can't make any sense of it yet. It's a very good point, because you can encrypt it now, but in a couple of years they probably can decrypt it. Can we keep the questions? Yeah, to the end. And another thing you can protect yourself against is the bull run stuff, where actually the NSA builds in back doors in your software or in your hardware or whatever. You can protect yourself by using, for instance, free software, because then you can look at the source code of your program and see if there are any backdoors in there. And this is the explanation about that, because if you want to really be sure that you are not monitored, you are monitored, but that they actually are not doing it on your computer, you need to be in control of your technology that you're using. And free software allows you to use and modify and share and distribute the software that you are using. And this way you can check if there are any backdoors or anything any other stuff that's in there. And even if, you know, at some point we get laws like, you know, that encryption is completely forbidden, or, you know, you can't use, you have to use a certain other way of communicating with free software, you know, you can just share it and build something that, you know, that you won't be able to do that. Or as Ibn Moglen said in a very interesting speech, I put a link at the end of the presentation, at Republica 2012, he said, "Free thought requires free media, and free media requires free technology." And that's just a basic, the whole basic thing. I don't believe that, I completely agree with Ibn that I don't think we can be completely free if we, in the 21st century, if we don't use free technology. And Snowden has proven proven this very well, I believe. So, what can we do? That's of course the most important question here. I looked at a couple of layers actually. I started with the hardware and then went to the OS, and well, then you get encryption and email and browsing. I just gave a general overview, and we're going to look at two specific points later. Well, first of all, hardware. We can't be 100% sure that all the stuff we get from the United States or from an American company that produces stuff in China is actually, that doesn't contain a keylogger or something else, or a sort of firmware that can be activated on at a distance. So how do we manage to protect ourselves from those kind of attacks? Well, for instance, by using open hardware. I've written down BeagleBoard. That's one of the open hardware projects. You can just look at the design and even build it yourself. Get the chips yourself. Maybe change a couple of chips if you don't trust the supplier of the chips. For a couple of years, people thought you could use an AirGap, a computer that is not connected to the internet, for all of this. Just to make sure that, you know, the things you do on that computer are safe. Well, as it turns out, there's a way to actually get around that problem, or to get for the NSA to actually activate at a distance the radio chips and just get data from your system anyway. So if you don't have a SCIF room, you know, the how do you say, a Faraday cage, then yeah, you need to combine those two technologies. Well, as an operating system, there are a couple of operating systems that have privacy and security, as a private and security focused. One of the most interesting ones is Tails. And what this actually does is it routes all the network traffic that you have through Tor, and Tor is an anonymizing network, and that way you at least make it very difficult for the NSA to connect you as a person to the data that you're spreading. I'm not saying it's 100% safe, but it makes it more difficult. Another thing that it does is it uses a project HTTPS everywhere, so any connection that you can make over HTTPS will be done over HTTPS, so that's very convenient as well. It also wipes your memory after you use it. It's a live distribution, so you just boot it up, and you know, it doesn't leave a trace on your computer. You can also, of course, use boot integrity and golden images, that you just make sure that the thing that you are what you are booting, that hasn't been tampered with. And then there's a question mark with SE Linux, because everybody knows that the NSA actually helped build SE Linux. And now, of course, the question rises, how safe is that? And there are another couple of other free software projects that are being investigated quite intensively to check if there are any backdoors in there. But that's of course convenient because we can look at the source code. Encryption. Well, GPG comes into mind. You can just encrypt everything that you send over, the data that you are sending over over the internet, the emails that you send, but also the documents you can encrypt with GPG. For physical security, you can also just encrypt your hard drive. But that doesn't immediately protect you from all the snooping stuff. Well, email. That's interesting. You can, if you still want to use something like, you know, the functionality of Gmail, but without all the privacy and security issues, there are a couple of email providers in this world that actually warrant of give you a lot of privacy and a lot of security. Most of them are in Switzerland. That's because of their legal system, which makes it extremely difficult for an security agency to ask for the data. So the data that is stored there is pretty much safe. Well, maybe not physical. You still have to investigate that, but at least from a legal perspective, it's pretty much safe. And there's browsing. Yeah, you need to watch out for cookies. Each page that contains a like button, you know, as Eben Moglen said, you know, still gives you gives Facebook data about that you visit actually such a page that has a like button on it, and that you clicked it or that you didn't click it. So it still generates a lot of information about what interests that you actually have. Of course, for browsing, you can also use Tor to randomize, you know, all the metadata that you spread out. It doesn't. Tor is not 100% safe, but it makes it difficult, as I said. I'm very happy with CAcert because, you know, if you think about VeriSign and all the other CAs that are in the world. Most of them are from the United States, and you know, I'm not saying that the NSA has a copy, but it could very well be that they actually, you know, if you make use of SSL, could very well be that it actually doesn't matter because the NSA can decrypt the whole session anyway. So basically, all those things, they fall again into categories: securing the route, you know, the internet traffic that you generate, and securing the cargo, the things that you send over the internet. So there are actually two general things that you can do. Well, for the first, is you need to secure the route. You need to, that's about talking about metadata. You need to make sure that that's randomized and anonymized. So you can use Tor or proxies or something like that. Or you can just balkanize the internet and just use some kind of darknet together with your friends that you trust the most. Securing the cargo. Well, there are a couple of things that you can use for that. You can use GPG to make sure that it's the data is encrypted. You can use OTR for chat. That's a very interesting project as well. And of course, you can use VPNs or HTTPS to secure the cargo. But that's just the technology side. All those free software projects and you know, they're very nice, but like I said, it doesn't stop the snooping. It doesn't stop the total indiscriminate surveillance. And I'm not saying that surveillance is bad, but the total indiscriminate part is bad. It shouldn't be that everybody from, if you are, you know, a vice president all the way to the United Nations and the European Commission, all those people are being monitored and listened to, and they're not listened to stop terrorists. They're listened to gain political power or to have some sort of influence in the world. And well, that's my personal opinion. I don't think that's what we should use surveillance for. So we should stop surveilling everybody and just start investigating and focus on the people that you know, we know are not very healthy for a society. You know, there will always be people who try to make a point by blowing up stuff, and I think we should surveil those and not people, you know, that are just living their lives. That's another problem. So we need to rethink spying, and we all have a responsibility there, because we allowed this to happen. We chose the people who are in power now, and they did this. But they also did this because, you know, when stuff happened, we screamed, "We want those terrorists to be found by any means necessary." Well, these are the any means, and I think we have a responsibility to let the people who are in charge hear that well, this is not the way we think this should be done. And unfortunately, we as IT people actually know all this stuff and can explain it, and it's not the, you know, the bakery guy at the corner who understands what is all happening. No, it's us. It's us as IT people. We unfortunately know how all this stuff works, and we know what the consequences are, and we realize how fast this surveillance is. And so we have the responsibility to explain this to our friends, to our neighbors, to our family, to everybody that we know. Just how it works and why it's bad, because people just don't know and don't realize. Well, they're starting to, you know. It's today is for the first day that when I heard on the radio about the Indian Prime Minister, that, you know, the sentence was, a lot of people in the world are starting to worry about this whole mass surveillance thing, and we have been hearing about this mass surveillance stuff for at least half a year, but just now people are starting to realize just a little bit what's actually happening. So we have a responsibility as IT people to actually explain this to everybody that we know. So the question part, we have 6 minutes, I believe. Let's start over there. Yeah. I'll just repeat the question. It's okay.
Yeah. You know, it's not a question. I just want to add, I have made my antithesis, and I want to add a synthesis. So I think that not only surveillance, but the major impact is that all this stuff, including surveillance, it is, from the perspective of general public, it is a black box. They absolutely have no idea how does it work, but it is a very trusted by general public black box, because it originated from authorities which used to be trusted. I don't know why, really. I see no reason to trust authorities personally. And at the same time, this black box is a part of computers, is a part of a white magic of computers. It must be doing something good, because it's computers. They are so wondrous. They make our life better, you know, Twitter, Facebook, all this stuff. So actually, this tribal black box, authorities and white magic of computers, it somehow indulges any injustice originated from this black box. It somehow indulges any physical violence against victims of the prison. From the perspective of general public, a victim of a prison became guilty because of the fact of the suspicion of a suspicion on the side of authorities. So this indiscriminate surveillance, largely supported with public fear of terrorism and stuff, you know, largely supported by authorities' propaganda originated from state authorities. It actually makes, it actually wake up a medieval subconscious in us. It makes us think that if they took him, therefore he'd done something bad. So it makes arrests and repressions self-indulgent things. Just if they exist, there must be a very good reason, and they, state authorities, they must know what they do. This is the major impact, and it's very important. It is the very same reason for which Gulag and Auschwitz and Buchenwald were possible. And this reason is here.
Yeah, so you're saying that because the you know, it was built by the elected people, by the government, you know, the system.
Elected.
Yeah, well, by the government, that it has some sort of it beams out some sort of sense of trustworthy authority. And if you get arrested because of, you know, you're monitored by PRISM, then you must also be a terrorist, because
this surveillance you mentioned, it mostly indulges any injustice.
Yeah.
That's very significant feature.
Yeah, that's. I think you are absolutely right, and it's up to us to explain to the public that you know, how it really works, and what it looks like, and why. Yeah, and like you said, it's, you know, one, this is one of the effects, and that is actually hurting our society. Yeah.
Yeah. Two things. The first thing to the Moroccan case. You don't need, if you have 100 people, persons, you don't need to arrest all 100. It would be reached that you arrest 10 or 5 of them.
Yeah, but why
do... You randomize the arresting, so the other 90 or 95 are in fear.
Yeah, but why do 5 if you can take them all 100?
But you need to take all 100 to to make 100 people in to make 100 people in fear, it's enough to arrest 5.
Yeah, but it's now so easy to find out. So the reason that, you know, you might not need all the 100 people, but it's so easy now to find out who everybody is.
Yeah.
So you just, as a government, you just take them all, then you're sure that.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Because prisons are not very cheap, you see.
Yeah.
The second thing is about encryption and decryption.
Mm-hmm.
I think we should encrypt all our mails. Even we think it could be disturbed in any time. Because it makes each description has a price, and it makes the price very much higher to be encrypt all. And each encrypted mail is a political statement that we like our privacy. It's a political statement. If you encrypt your mail, it's a political statement.
Exactly, and well, he says you just encrypt everything because, you know, it's hard to decrypt, so it makes the price higher to do it, and it's a political statement. And actually, in the Snowden documents, it makes you more suspicious. That was funny. Well, thank you all for the time.